Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. All glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. God bless you. So thank you so much, Neil and team, for this awesome time of worship and leading us into the Word of God. It's so wonderful to be here and share God's Word with all of you. And the topic was, God turns ordinary into extraordinary. God turns ordinary into extraordinary. How many of you want to be extraordinary? Nobody? Only a few first benches. Yeah? Yeah, sure. That's all. Few hands. Yeah, you should. I think you will lift both the hands and lift the legs too. You know, so excited. God, you're going to make me extraordinary. You know, it's only God who does that. Amen? So I'll be sharing both from the Old Testament and the New Testament, and start with the Old Testament with the life and the story of Gideon. You know Gideon? Many of you know. He is the second judge from the Old Testament. He was the first one was? The first judge of the Old Testament? Okay, I'll leave that as homework. Not making it easier for you. Go back and search. So he's the second judge. So this, you have seen the Israelites, you know, the time they were taken from the, taken to the promised land. And they have been constantly obeying God and disobeying God, like a seesaw. Obeying God for a season and then disobeying God for a season. Obeying God, disobeying God. And just went on like, you know, swaying back and forth for many years. And when they would disobey God, God would give them, you know, there was a level of punishment. And the last punishment would be, he would send them into exile. He would send them into exile. And this point of time in the Israelites, during the time of second judges, is a book of Judge chapter 6 onwards. You can read the chapter about the Midianite oppression. Now, the entire Israelite country was under the oppression of the Midianites and the Amalekites. Basically, the Midianites. The Midianites were there oppressing the people of the Israel. And these Israelites are now crying out to God, God, give us a deliverer. Send someone who will deliver us. And God speaks to them and tells them, you've been doing this on and off. This is not the first time. But I love you, so I will send you a deliverer. And whom does he go and choose? He chooses a man. He goes to Gideon. And who's Gideon? Gideon is from one of the 12 tribes of Israel, the smallest tribe, called from the tribe of Manasseh. And he's from the smallest family. And he considered himself absolutely nothing. He was actually in farming. He's not even a soldier or a warrior by profession. He's a farmer. He's tilling his land. And the angel of God comes and calls him, Gideon, you mighty warrior. You are going to come and lead my people out from their exile. And he's shocked. In which way do I look mighty to you, Lord? He's asking. I'm small. I'm insignificant. Nobody knows about me. I'm from the smallest tribe, the smallest family, totally of no significance. And you want me to lead this, you know, the people, your people from the Midianites? They are like, you know, like swamps. They're all over the place. The numbers you cannot count. Some say the soldiers themselves were over 1 million soldiers. There's so many of them. And I'm not a warrior. I'm not a strong man. I'm not a man who knows how to use weapons. And you're asking me, and God says, yes, you are a mighty warrior. Lead me. So as normal human beings, how do I know you are God? So give me some proof. Give me some signs, which all of us ask, right? It's a disease which has hit mankind from day one till now, probably. Everybody wants a sign. Lord, show me that you are God. How are you going to do it? He says, okay, I'm going to get, you know, I'm going to prepare some food and you have to eat that food. So he goes into the house, he takes some meat, he takes some unleavened bread, he brings it out and leaves it on the rock. And the angel of the Lord touches the rock and fire comes and devours the entire thing. He said, oh, okay, yes, I know you're God, because he's read his Bible. He knows, like, sorry, not the Bible. He's read the Old Testament, Torah. He knows that this has happened in the past. Then still he's not fully 100% sure that you're God. He says, okay, God, one more sign, please. He says, okay, what? He says, the fleece of the cotton, of the lamp, that is the covering of the lamp, which they take off and they make garments, that fleece is there. I will take the fleece and I'll place it, see to it that the fleece is full of dew, but all the land around it is dry. So next day morning he goes and he sees the fleece, only the fleece is full of dew. So he takes and squeezes the water from that, he gets a bucket of water, but the land around is all dry. Again he's confused. Again he says, Lord, one more sign, please. Now do it the other way around. Let the fleece be dry, but let all the area around it be wet. And God does that. He says, okay, Lord, now I know you are truly God. Now tell me, what am I supposed to do? He says, take your men and you need to go to war. He says, how many men he has? He's counting, calculations, 32,000 people. And the army is 1 million. 1 million is around 10 lakh people. So 32,000 of his army to fight how many people? 10 lakh people, 1 million people. And he says, this is absolutely wrong maths. It's not possible at all. And God looks at him and says, no, you're too many. You're just too many. So you go to your team and you tell them, anyone who's scared or who's in fear, ask them to go. Anyone who is in fear, ask them to go. And how many people go away? 22,000 people return. How many are left with him? 10,000. He had 32,000 and God has removed how many? 22,000. They're scared. I don't want to go to war. They've gone back home. He has 10,000. Now he's looking at the Lord and saying, 10,000 is so less compared to 10 lakh. So less. Totally maths has gone completely haywire with you, Lord. He's a little angry with God, I believe. So then God says, no, this is also too many. This is too many people with you. You need to reduce the number of people. So take them to the stream, and this is what you're going to do, what you're going to observe. Everyone who, you know, bends into the stream and licks the water like a dog, like you lap the water, no? Lick. How does a dog? I can't show it to you. So you understand, how does a dog lick water? It's those people you take to one side, and all those who are putting their hand in, taking water and gulping it, put them into the other side. So the number of people who were lapping the water were around 300. And they were on one side. The remaining, how much? 7,700 were on the other side. God says, take the 300. He says, what's wrong with you, God, now? You brought it down from 32,000 to 300 people. He says, now you will go to war against 1 million people. And then what does he give him? When you go to war, what do you take with your weapons? If we had to go for a war now, what will we take with us? Knives and forks? What will you take? What you will take? AK-47, right? Or something much more. I'm saying times now. AK-47 is also outdated, I believe. There'll be something much more. You take, what you take? Weapons of mass destruction, right? You will take, like, I take one gun, shoot, and 300 people are dead. We want those kind of weapons. But you know, with what weapons did Gideon go to war? Because he didn't know how to fight. He took one, in one hand, he took trumpet. And in the other hand, he took a jar. And under the jar was a lighted torch, an inverted jar. And under the jar was a lighted torch. Torch is giving you light. It's fire. Fire, and there's a jar. And 300 people are going to go, and their duty is to destroy an army of 10 lakh people. You know? And Gideon is worried, scared. And just the night before the time that they had decided to go on war, he sees some people sitting and talking. And in that, one particular person is telling a dream that he had dreamt. And in that dream, the interpretation of the dream was that God is going to give victory to Gideon. And hearing that, he is fully charged up. Like, yes, the Lord is with us. So this 300 people, he divides them into 100, 100, 100. Into three different groups of 100 each. And imagine a valley and the army is all over here. And these are people who are surrounding the mountains. They are all around the mountains. So he asks these three different troops to charge in from three different directions. The moment he gives the indication for the war to start. So the moment the indication is given, all the 300 of them, they blow the trumpets. They break the jar. And they're running and charging down the mountain. So imagine an entire army who was totally unprepared for this, suddenly sees light and trumpet for all over the place coming down. They take these swords and they kill each other. The army kills each other and Gideon wins the battle. Amen? Amen. Can we give God a big round of applause? Why do you think God downsized the army? Why do you think God downsized the army? You don't have to be right or wrong. Anything which comes in your mind. Anything? Why did God downsize the army? To confuse the enemies. Downsize the army to confuse enemies. Because so that tomorrow the Gideon and his team should not say that we won the war on our. It was me. My intelligence, my strength, my, you know, the army, the people I have, the thought process, the weapons I have. It was totally nothing of the people. It was 100% everything of God. So God had to downsize it to such a limit that nobody in that whole team would be able to praise themselves for their victory. It definitely 100% is the hand of God. Because without God, it is totally impossible. God made that ordinary Gideon into an extraordinary military in charge, commander in charge. A person who was a farmer, who was hiding, who was scared, who was one of the smallest tribe of Israel, from the 12 tribes, the tribe of Manasseh, and he makes him into the commander in chief of Israel. And he rules for 40 years. He's a great commander. From nothing, he became everything. And this story continues through the whole of the Old Testament. Gideon is just one of them. You know all the other stories. There are so many stories where God chooses people who are absolutely insignificant and makes them into heroes. All of us similarly fall into the same category. See, when God also was choosing, he has come to the earth, he has been given 3.5 years, he has a ministry with his 12 disciples and, you know, not apostles 12, but he has his so many hundreds of disciples. He's going to walk with them, teach with them, and now he needs a mission. He has to send out 12 of them to the field. You have to go to the ends of the earth and proclaim the good news. So he has to choose how many people? He has to choose how many? 12. So suppose you are now, imagine you are in the place of God. Imagine. And you have a commission that you have to spread, you know, the good news to the ends of the earth. And in your hands has been given the authority to pick up 12 people. Whom will you pick? Whom will you pick? I'm saying, suppose, imagine you are Jesus. It's imagination, sister. You can imagine. Just imagine you're, I didn't say you're Jesus, I said just imagine. So what would you pick? Whom would you pick? You would pick, fantastic sister. Capable people then? Powerful people, yes, fantastic brother then? Would you pick someone who's, I'm sorry? Influential people, fantastic. Always ready to, this very typically someone who knows the word of God very well, giving all worldly, godly answers. I'm saying the worldly answers. Sister is too good. Yes. Then, like in the word, generally think. Don't think, huh? Our friends, you'll pick your friends. Yes. Then, near and dear ones. Yes. Near and dear ones? I'm not so sure. Okay. Yes. So imagine Jesus has now to pick up 12 people whom he is going to give the responsibility of spreading about the kingdom of God to the entire world. And before Jesus does anything dramatic or significant in his life or anything new that's happening, Jesus always goes and prays. He always prays. And this particular time also, in the book of Luke, the Jesus picking up all the disciples is given in all the synoptic gospels, in Matthew, Mark, Luke. And in Luke specifically in chapter 6 verse 12, I'll just read very fast so that you can go back and then read slowly. Verse 12, chapter 6 verse 12. Now during those days he went out to the mountain to pray, and he spent the night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose 12 of them, whom he also named apostles: Simon, whom he called Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James and John and Philip and Bartholomew, and Matthew and Thomas, and James son of Alphaeus, and Simon who was called the Zealot, and Judas son of James, and Judas Iscariot, and who became a traitor. So the thing is that now Jesus is going to go in the morning and he's going to choose the 12. Such an important decision for Jesus. He had hundreds of people who were following him, but he had to pick up 12, only 12. And among the 12, he had to pick up someone who is going to go outside to the ends of the earth, even up to India, up to China, up to all over the world to preach the news. So he's praying for, practically some of the commentators say that he prayed for 12 hours. He prayed for how many hours? For 12 hours, long hours of the night, he was praying to his Father. He was in communion with his Father, praying to God, Lord, help me pick up these 12. So you think this 12 hours that he is praying, when he comes out, he's going to pick up the best. The best in every field. But when he comes out and he picks, you're quite surprised with his choice of people. You're quite surprised. Lord, you prayed for 12 hours for this? These 12 people? Ordinary people. Not even one was a scholar or a teacher. Not even one was a educated human being or a person. See, the first person he picked up was who? Andrew. Andrew was a fisherman. And Andrew went and got whom? His brother, Simon, who's also a fisherman. Then he picked up the sons of Zebedee, James and John. Who are they? They're also fishermen. All four fishermen. The remaining, the eight of them, one was a tax collector. Matthew was a tax collector, a Levi, whom, even the Israelites didn't like. He was not the near and dear one. He was someone they hated. Why they hated him? Because he was working for the Romans. He was extracting tax from his own people and giving to the Roman people. His own people, his own parents hated him. And he was not even a truthful guy. He was a treacherous guy. He was to take, suppose he used to take, he has to take 10 rupees as tax. He was taking 40 rupees. Four times more he was charging. So nobody liked him. He was not someone who was likable. You would like to have a leader whom you like, right? Would you want to have a leader whom you don't like? No. Look at all the others. Just random. Philip, Bartholomew. Nathaniel is also called as Bartholomew. Judas, one of the 12, also betrayed him. My God, Jesus, what did you do for those 12 hours? What was your prayer like? What did you pray? You prayed to get this kind of people? You would want, you were at Jesus at that time, what would you do? I need 12 people. So where will I go? I will go to the University of Jerusalem, right? Like how you have IITs and IIMs in India, in Bangalore. What would you? You go to the dean of the college and say, Doctor, I need the best brains in your college, the top 12 students, the best orator, the best mathematician, the best financial and analyst, the best financier, who has lots of money. The one who is so full of knowledge in every area. We want the 12 best. But look, what do you have chosen? What did you choose? All these people, what they are going to take and preach the gospel to the ends of the world? How are they going to? Jesus, you made a mistake. There's something wrong you did on that night when you prayed. Was it a mistake what Jesus did? Or was it not? What do you think? Jesus made a mistake? No. Jesus didn't make a mistake. Only Kiran is very sure. Rest are not so sure whether Jesus made a mistake or not. Did Jesus make a mistake? Imagine you have been given a lot of imagination. Imagine you could go into that night of prayer. where Jesus was praying those 12 hours for his, to choose his apostles to his Father, what would his prayer have been like? He would have said, Lord, let me not choose the way the world does. Let me not choose the way the world does. Let me choose the way you would choose. Let me choose the way you would choose. Means let me not go according to the world system. The world is always looking for the brightest, the best, the, you know, the everything, the best. They want them in the top. You want your children, you want the children to top the class. You want them to be best in, you know, in academics. You want them best in sports. You want them to be best orators. You want them to be best in everything. Every parent is like that. And the world is like that. Somebody goes for a job interview, they want the best. Did you top in your class? What courses have you taken? Are you best in this? Are you best in that? The best system rules the world. He says, no, that's not the way God chooses. Why? Why does God not look at our capabilities? You know, this is very deep. If you understand this, your concept of Christianity would change. God is not concerned with our education, our knowledge, how much we know, how much we have achieved in this world. He's not concerned why. I'll come to the answer why later. I'll just give an example now. Suppose you come to my house. I make a big, you know, lot of people, so I make lots of tea. And I take a tray and I put different jars of different, you know, some made up of, earthen teacup, a steel cup, a ceramic cup, a cup made up with silver cup, a golden cup, a diamond cup, a platinum cup. I pour tea into it and I bring it to you. And I say, you can pick up only one. Which one would you choose? Golden cup, sister. Praise God. Only she will take the tea. You will take the? The best one. Praise God, sister. Yes. Then, what would you choose? Diamond cup. Very good, brother. Then? Mud. You will take the mud one. Mud one. Okay. Fantastic, brother. Yes? So only mud, only one is taking. Rest all want diamond and gold. Anybody else? Or you say, I don't drink tea, I drink coffee. Last time I was stumped with this question. Somebody answered me back, Doctor, I don't drink tea, so I won't pick up any of the term. I want coffee. So you have chosen mud pot, you have chosen diamond, gold, and diamond and everything. So you have taken that. What is inside of that? The tea. The tea was made by whom? Made by me. Does the quality of the tea change in any of the cups? No, it doesn't change. Only the container has changed. But what has been poured into it is the same in all the cups? Are you sure? Or in the mud pot, I put a different tea. In the diamond pot, I put a different tea. No. The containers are different, but the tea is the? Tea is the? Are you sure? Yes. The tea is the same in all the things. Only the containers are different. So keep this thought in your mind. I'll come back at the end towards this. Okay. So what God is telling is that He is not a respecter of any person. It may sound cruel to hear, but He is not a respecter of any person. He does not say, oh, you are the head, so you are great. You are the sweeper in the house, so you are the least. You understanding? That's the meaning of respecter. He does not give respect to the commander of the army and say, oh, I hold you in high esteem, and the small soldier down, oh, I don't care about you. He is not the respecter of any person. Who are you? You can be the prime minister of the country, or you can be, you know, the head of the electorate, or you could be anything. And a normal person, there is no difference. God knows that when He is going to give the responsibility to the 12, it could be any 12. Nobody is capable of doing that work. What does He know? That nobody can do the work that they are commissioned to do. That's why when Jesus resurrection, He is going to go to heaven. What does He tell those 12, all the people who are gathered in the upper room? There are 120 of them. He says, he didn't tell them, oh, I've gone to heaven, and all of you go preach the gospel. Did he tell that? No. What did he tell? Stay. And who's going to come? I'm going to send my helper. And when my helper comes, he will strengthen you, he will fill you, he will anoint you, he will give you everything that you require, and then go preach the gospel. Did you get it? So it is nothing of you. Every person, like every human being, is the same for God. But how this ordinary becomes extraordinary is only when the helper comes. When the Holy Spirit comes upon them, every ordinary person becomes extraordinary. Amen? So this is for everybody. No one is exempted from this. And initially, the Holy Spirit came upon the 120 people who were in the upper room. And after that, the same Holy Spirit has come upon every believer in Christ. Amen? You don't believe. That's why you're saying, amen. If you believed it, if you knew even what I was trying to say, you will be jumping and lifting your hands up. Amen. Because this Holy Spirit is turning the ordinary you into the extraordinary person. There was a village far away in Germany, and people were living in complete isolation. They were pagans. They didn't believe in God. And there was one man over there who was extremely sick. He had rheumatism all over his body. He could hardly move. He could hardly walk. And he was crying day and night, and all the doctors and everyone, he treated him. But he was not healed at all. And one day, one preacher was walking along the way. He got lost. He, happened to come upon this village, lost his way, and came into this village. And when he came into this village, he says, oh, I'm lost. Anyway, since I'm here, let me do God's work. So he asked the first question, is anybody sick in this village? And immediately everybody said, yes, there is a man. Every doctor, everyone has, tried to help him, treat him, but he has not been healed. And his sounds of pain and agony we are hearing day and night. Can you heal him? He says, I can't, but my Jesus can. So bring him to me. And the moment that person was brought to him, this man of God prayed that God Almighty heal this man. And instantly he was healed. And the whole village embraced, and they became Christians. And this man's son is Renard Bonnke. Now, who's Renard Bonnke? He's one of the greatest evangelists the world has ever known, because he went into Africa, he preached the gospel, and a single man who brought almost 60 to 70 million souls to God. One single human being bringing 60 to 70 million souls he brought to God. One ordinary man who became extraordinary. That extraordinary happened because of the Holy Spirit. Nothing of his, everything of the Holy Spirit. So there is nothing of us, everything of the Holy Spirit. So beautifully, somebody asked him, how are you, in an interview, what do you consider yourself, your achievements of bringing so many people to the Lord? He says, I'm zero. I'm absolutely a zero. You know the number zero, how it looks like? Zero. He says, I'm a zero. But I have him as a partner with me, who's the number one, and he is Jesus. So when one is in front of zero, we become 10. We become 10. So my zero has got significance because of the one in front of my zero. I become 10. When 10 becomes 100, 100 becomes 1,000, 1,000 becomes 10,000, becomes a million, 10 million trillion. How much ever, all of them have got significance because there is one before all the zeros. So he says to the journalist that, I want to be the last zero in this entire, the number game that could be. I want to be the last zero. But even if we are the last zero and the one is taken away, what do we become? Back to? Did you understand? So our zero has significance because of the one who is in front of us. With him, we are more than conquerors. And who's a conqueror? Who's a conqueror? Christ Jesus. And he says, you are more than a conqueror. And I'm sending you to the world and you're going to do more than what I ever did. What Jesus did itself was outstanding. He opened the blind eye, the ears, the, you know, the deaf ears, the dumb mouth, paralyzed. He brought a dead back to life. And Jesus himself says in his word that you'll be doing much more than what I have ever done. How many of us believe that? Yes, Dr. Maria. Others are still not believing? Not believing? Only one brother said over there. Yes, Neil, Jerome, yes. Nelson, you're listening to the teaching for so many years. You still don't believe? You do? Sorry, he's just pulling his leg. He's a very sweetheart. Yeah. So, if we are not going to believe that, the believing is in our head. We will continue to live ordinary lives. And we would have taken the cup. What was poured in that was the Holy Spirit. The cup does not matter. Whether I am, you know, an insignificant mud, or I am the costliest, like something more than diamond, I don't know. There is what? Which is the greatest, platinum, something more than that. It does not matter. What matters is the Holy Spirit inside that cup. That Holy Spirit inside the cup, the Lord has given to each and every one of us. I need you to believe this. Otherwise, we will live our entire life here on earth as ordinary human beings who came, lived an ordinary human life, and died an ordinary death. And in our graves will be written, rest in peace. Nothing wrong. But we have not at all accomplished even an iota of what we are capable of with the Holy Spirit. Now you would say, like, how do I receive the Holy Spirit, right? Is there a question inside your mind? Yes. Yes. No, yes. Yes. See, we have received the Holy Spirit right from the time of the sacraments according to our church. Like the baptism, then you have the confirmation. In the time, the bishop lays his hand upon you and says, you have received the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit, that is by faith. You have received, every one of us have received the Holy Spirit. There is nobody who has not received it. Only you did not see it like on the day of Pentecost, like a huge wave coming in and tongues of flame sitting on our head. So since we don't see those signs, we believe, oh, the Holy Spirit has gone upon the preacher, has gone upon him and upon her and upon her, but not upon me. Yes or no? Yes or no? Be truthful. Yes. So the preacher is anointed, he can speak the word of God because upon him the Holy Spirit is anointed. He's not come upon me because I don't feel anything. I have not fallen down. I have not fainted. I am not speaking in tongues. I'm this and that. I can't do. So the Holy Spirit is not upon me. No. The Holy Spirit is upon everyone the day we received our sacraments. Amen. Now we need to do something. If I brought the teacups and I gave it to you, you took it from my hand, but you did not drink it, what would happen? Will you be able to taste the tea? I gave it to you, you took it also, and you keep it in your hand, but you don't drink it. Will you be able to relish the tea? Are you sure? It'll fly from the cup directly into your mouth? What do you have to do? You have to take it, and you have to sip it. And when you sip it, then you relish the tea. Then you can say, yes, doctor, it was good, it was bad, or not good, or not bad. So that tea, that substance to go inside of us, or the Holy Spirit to go inside of us, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to work in our lives. There is a portion of work that you and me have to do. Yes or not? Yes or not? You know, I'll just tell you how I got into this anointing of the Holy Spirit. Probably a diehard Catholic by nature. I am. So one long back, there was 2000 and 7, I guess. There was a meeting over here in NSK, and my brother-in-law, he said there is a great man of God, and that I have never seen anything like, you know, people are anointed, they're falling here, there, they're praying in tongues and this and that. So you need to come. You need to come. And so I said, definitely some Pentecostal guy, I'm not going. So he says, no, Leena, you need to come. You need to come. He forced us. So we went, me and my husband, and sat right at the last bench in NSK. And we said, just to tell my brother-in-law that we came. We are obedient to you. We came. You called us, we came. And the moment he starts his talk, I am going to disappear from the back. That was the plan that we had come with. And we sat in the last bench. It was fully jam-packed. And, you know, just maybe 10, 15 minutes into the session, and he just pulled out, that lady sitting in the last bench, the churidar, you know, he, and I'm looking, somebody else is there. Not me, you know, just looking at you, stand up, you know. I said, oh God, kahan phas gayi. I know he called me, and he called me to the front, and he just prayed and put his hand, and I was on the ground. I was slain. And almost for 1 hour, 45 minutes, I was on the ground. I had no clue what was happening. And when I woke up, I was already speaking in tongues, which I had never heard before. I started speaking in tongues. And then I had this, you know, the fear of standing in front of crowd and speaking. I would never, even in my medical college, you can ask me to do all the, you know, I will work up the patient and do everything. Dr. Maria will know. But when it comes to presentation, I'll give it to my friend. You read. I'll do all the hard work, write down all the entire documentation and everything. But I would never be able to stand and talk in front of anyone. And during one of the sessions, my husband, who was suffering from Crohn's for many years and was also suggested surgery at that point of time, he got completely healed. You know, so he would look at Suresh, where is Suresh, to come and share the testimony. And I do not know how Suresh would get a clue. Exactly at that moment, he would disappear. I don't know how he would find out that he is going to be pulled up onto the stage. He would disappear. So, you know, brother will be looking around, where is Suresh, where is Suresh? And then he can't find him. He will say, yes, doctor, you come up on stage. And I would be like, inside me, my heart is palpitating, you know, must be touching 120, 140. Such palpitations, my hands are shivering, shaking. And I would come back, and then after I would go give him a blasting. Next time you call me to the stage, you see what I'm going to do to you. So I would, you know, but somehow he would just start calling me, bringing me to the stage, and this fear that was inside of me, you know. So one day he called up on the stage, he says, God has not given you a spirit of fear. He's given you a spirit of sound mind and courage. And he prayed, and from that day, the fear just completely left. The next convention was on grounds in Goa, where there were more than 4,000 people present. And there, you know, went and stood on stage, I had absolutely no fear. God, the Holy Spirit took away the things that were not in me, that was not right, fear, anxiety, which was not from God. He filled with His Holy Spirit, and He said, you're going to go and teach the gospel. And from that day till now, it's probably, I believe, 16 years now that, you know, we have been teaching God's word. And I think the greatest privilege that a human being can ever receive is to use his mouth and speak the gospel. You should write this down. I hope you take this down and ingrain that in your head. The greatest privilege that a human being can ever get is to open your mouth and speak the gospel. Speak about His kingdom. Don't open your mouth and speak your problems and issues. They are there. You can look at me and say, oh, so I must be living an absolutely, fully, you know, like nothing missing, nothing broken in my life. No, more. There are so many things which are missing in my life. There are so many things which are broken in my life. I'm struggling with a lot of illnesses for the last 4 or 5 years. I've questioned, I have asked. And I know the answer to. But whatever could be it, there is nothing more beautiful than speaking about Him, the Creator. That in spite of these problems, these challenges and difficulties that I'm going through, still, Lord, I can open my mouth and I can praise You. I can thank You for what I have. And what I have lost also, Lord, I know they are with You. Whatever loss here in this kingdom is not considered a loss at all. It is a gain into His kingdom. Help me to overcome my challenges, my difficulties and everything. The greatest gift a human being can have is what? Is the privilege to open your mouth and speak the kingdom. You know, we live in a kingdom, we live in a world which is completely challenged. So many difficulties in this world. People call you, people speak to you, you meet people all the time. And you know, if you could open your mouth and just give them comfort, what could you say? Yeah, there is a problem. Fine, don't worry. There is a God and He loves you. Maybe just that simple word, Jesus loves you, will be so amazing. I had a girl walking down the road. I had a clinic in my house some years before. A girl was just walking down the road. And she just came in and sat in my clinic. I said, yes, not feeling well. And she starts crying. She says, no, I was walking down the road and I felt so much in my heart that go in, go talk to her. So she listened to the voice and she came into the clinic. And she came to the clinic and she was only crying. I said, why are you crying? What happened? And as the thing unfolded, she had decided to give up her life. And she's crying and walking down the road. And at that moment, God told her, just go talk to her. So when I opened and I started speaking words which the Lord gave to speak to her, she was so comforted. She came, hugged me, and she says, I'm not going to kill myself now. It's not me. You believe it's not me at all. I was just willing to become the cup so that His Holy Spirit could do the work. The onus is never on you. Don't worry. Oh, I'm going to pray for him and that person is going to get healed. No, you are not going to do any healing with your powers and whatever you might have. There is nothing that you can do. But Jesus and the Holy Spirit can do anything and everything. There are testimonies of people who came, like I have shared in my ministry, the kids will be knowing of people, no children. Or the child, one girl who came and, they said the baby has to be aborted. It is the fifth month. You need to abort the child because there is no fluid in the stomach. And they came in all the way from a village near Vellore. The whole family came to the clinic. I'm not a gynecologist. I'm just a general medicine doctor. So they came to the gynecologist that, we know that you pray and, things happen. So I prayed. I said, Lord, I don't know what to do. This is not my case. So Lord said, you open the drawer, there is a tablet, a paper has come, take that, prescribe and send it to the patient. And first time in my life, I bought a drug which I have no clue about. I just listened to the Lord, took that paper, wrote the prescription, gave it to them and told them, you take these medicines and after a particular time, you have to repeat a scan and come back and see me. And when they went, I said, Lord, what on earth? First time in my life, I have given a prescription I have no clue of. What did you ask me to write? So I took out the paper and I read. It was a medicine that helps the fetal nutrient like a B complex for the baby. So I wrote that, and those 2 weeks I was praying so much, because if the child would develop, they said the child would have definitely psychological and mental retardation, mental physical retardation. Child will not be born normal because there is zero amniotic fluid. So 2 weeks, more than the patient, I was praying. And asking my mom to pray. Mom, please pray. Like this is, by faith. And 2 weeks later, they did the scan and the fluid has started forming. And a month later, everything is absolutely normal. And they brought the child to the clinic after a year of her birth. Fully, perfectly normal. No signs of any abnormality of any kind. This is when you choose to become a vessel that God can use. I don't know whether I am even capable of being that, the mud pot? I don't know what I am. But with God inside of me, He turns me from the ordinary to the extraordinary. And that same God is working with each and every one of you. That's why He said God is not a respecter of any person. He loves everybody. And the same Holy Spirit, without measure, He pours down onto everyone. And everyone, He's given a gift. Someone for teaching, someone for healing, someone for building the community. So we are a community of believers. And all of us are required to, each of us, to work together to build His kingdom. Amen? You believe that? You believe that? You surely believe that? That you are willing to become the vessel that God can pour His Spirit upon? Yes or no?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you sure? I would like a big yes.
Yes.
Amen. Some little louder.
Yes.
Amen. That's nice. So when each of you, if one Renard Bonke can bring 60 to 70 million souls to Christ, and we can unlock that potential, that it's just our faith. I believe God loves Renard Bonke the same way. God loves Pope Francis the same way. And God loves us the same way. He is not at all showing any kind of partiality. He's the same God, the same Holy Spirit. If you want to receive that anointing, I just say, stand up on your feet and we shall pray. Just close your eyes. Nothing that I'm asking that you need to do, you just need to believe. What you need to do is only, don't be scared. God is not going to asking you to do anything that he's the Holy Spirit who is going to empower you to do and live your life so that the day when we go back and meet our Maker, God is going to say, come into my kingdom, my worthy child. I have prepared this kingdom for you. Do you want to hear that or not? Or do we want to die like as though we never existed, of no significance to any human being? Or do we want to die after we have fulfilled what God has called us to do? It's our choice. It's your choice. It's my personal choice. No one can do it for us. It's our faith, our belief. So right now, just close your eyes. You just need to focus only on Jesus. And make yourself into that worthy vessel where the Holy Spirit can come in and dwell. Amen? Amen. So just close your eyes. Abba Father, we thank you and praise you, God, for your word is alive and active, sharper than a double-edged sword, O Master. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, your word says, ask and you shall receive. And you, when you went up from here, O God, you said that, wait, I'm sending forth your helper, a helper who will be with you, who will come into you, and then you will be able to do everything that you were thought was not possible by you, O God. And he will be with you, he will guide you, he will lead you, he'll empower you. He'll take away that spirit of fear and fill you with courage, with strong mind, O God, and with confidence in his word, O God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, O Lord. Lord, help our unbelief, O Master. Thank you for all the people who are present over here, O God. They are your children, O God, whom you created in your image, O Master. And each one you created as a masterpiece, O Master. Abba, we thank you and praise you, God, that we anoint every year present over here, O God. Every single individual who's listening to this teaching, O Master. That right now, wherever they might be, O God, as they close their eyes and they listen to your word, O God. Thank you, Shikasaraba. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, O God, that you are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, and you are the creator, O God. And thank you, Jesus, you give. You give, and you continue to pour, O God, your spirit upon each and every one of us, O Master. Thank you, Jesus, as on the beginning of the book of Genesis, O God, like the Holy Spirit was hovering over the face of the earth, O God, and you spoke a word, let there be light, and the Holy Spirit went and accomplished that, O Master. Thank you, Jesus, O God. We stand and we speak your word, O God, and thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit is anointing each and every person present over here, O God, that they are receiving the Holy Spirit, O God. They are receiving the anointing of the Holy Spirit in their life, O God. Thank you, Shikasaraba, O God, in a very tangible way, O God, that they will never forget this day ever in their lives, O Master. Oh, Shikasaraba. Thank you, Shikasaraba. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, O God. Thank you, Jesus. You're coming upon them. You're coming upon them, flames of fire, O God. You're speaking to them, O God. Thank you, Jesus. What was impossible before, it becomes possible now, O God. You break the shackles of unbelief in the people, O God. Thank you, Shikasaraba. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Shika Saraba. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. You continue to close your eyes. Thank you.
If you